my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. Today, I wanted to talk about something that I've discussed in past videos, but I want to take a different spin on it, and it's how to find the right PhD advisor for your topic. This is really thinking about selecting a PhD advisor that will best serve your research interests. There's a lot of different ways to pick a PhD advisor, and I think this is a really good way. And I'll talk about tips and tricks for really finding the right PhD advisor and how to identify if their topic fits what you're going to study and how to allow yourself to grow in that topic over time. So let's jump on in. So like I alluded to, there's a lot of different ways to pick a PhD advisor. Some good ways, some not so good ways. I think one of the best ways is to focus on your topic and try to make sure that what your advisor studies and their style aligns with your topic. Okay. So first of all, you need to know what your topic is. And that can be tricky. The idea is that you'll want to identify a specific area of research because a particular area of research has some unique qualities. It's going to have methods that they use, specific methods. It's going to have tools that they use, and it's going to have theories that drive the vast majority of research. So you want to have a PhD advisor that can align on those three metrics with you. In particular, the tools and the methods are really important to make sure that there is alignment there. So you kind of need to know what your topic is before starting. If you want a video on how to pick a PhD topic, let me know. I'm happy to do that. But say you know what your topic is. When you're looking at different advisors, what you want to do is to first look at the methods that they use. The reason that a method alignment between what you want to do and what a PhD advisor does is important is because they will often nudge you into using their methods because they can understand them. It can be really challenging to advise someone coming from an advisor standpoint if you actually don't know how to use a particular method that the student is using. It can be very scary because you can't ensure that they're doing it correctly, you can't quality control, you can't give them advice about different, you know, choices within that method. So oftentimes you see advisors kind of trying to nudge students into using their methods, even if they started out wanting to use different methods. So when you're selecting an advisor, you need to ensure that the methods that they use are ones that you would like to use as well. You might not need to know all of those methods, you can learn them as you go. So you need to ensure that the methods that they use align with what you'd like to get out of the experience, as well as align with your skill sets, so you could actually implement those methods. Or maybe you already have a background in some of those. The next important element of that is ensuring that they use the materials and the equipment that align with what you want to do. For example, they might have a particular lab with a set of equipment that they need to use for grant and other reasons, and you will find that they will try to nudge you into using that particular equipment. In contrast, you might want to do research that involves equipment that they don't have. So either you're going to have to collaborate with someone else who has that equipment, or get your advisor to purchase said equipment or time on that equipment. They will be reluctant to buy new equipment for you if it's just for you, because it's usually a big investment. Most equipment is, you know, upward of $20,000, and they don't just have those types of funds lying around. What you can do is oftentimes utilize equipment that the department has or the university has. When that is the case, like say for example, you want to use an fMRI machine, your advisor probably doesn't have one in their lab. Those are, you know, $1 million pieces of equipment. What tends to happen is they're allowed to purchase time on that equipment. So you need to ensure if you want to use equipment like that, that they have the funds to do it, that they're willing to fund that project, or you're willing to procure your own grant funding to get time on those machines. University is a business to some degree. So if there's a shared resource, it's usually not free. You have to pay for time on that shared resource, which students don't always know. So in addition to methods and equipment, you also want to ensure that you have the same vision for research as your advisor. And I think that this is, you know, equally as important as the previous two. But what I'm really saying here is that they will have a vision for where they think research should go, where they think the lab's research should go. You need to share that vision. You might have big dreams of kind of moving into this space or advancing the work in a certain way. That needs to match what they expect as well, because you will find that they will add these subtle pressures, and ultimately you will probably end up doing the type of research or the vision that they see for the lab. So you want to make sure that that aligns with what you would like to do. One approach is to do basic science that then builds up to more applied research. that might be the way that you want to do it. So you do these incremental studies building up to something more important. Another approach is to start with a big important problem and then decompose it and decompose it and decompose it. So those are two very different pathways to doing research, and you and your advisor might disagree on the approach. So it will be very tricky to make sure that you can stay true to your research if you have conflicting visions for the research as a whole. So how do you figure out if there is a match, right? Those are three fairly technical things I just described. How in the world would you know if your approach matches a potential advisor's approach? I think the first thing to do is to, of course, take a look at all of the materials they have online. You can look at their most recent publications to get a sense of the methods they use. So that should be pretty straightforward. What you could do is take the last 5 years of publications that they have and look at the methods in all of those publications. That will give you a range of methods that they are using in the last 5 years. It will also give you a clue about the type of equipment that they're using or excited to be using. In addition to that, you can take a look at the most recent grant funding that they've received. They might have received grant funding to purchase a piece of equipment. If that's the case, then you can expect that piece of equipment to be coming online for you to use once you start your PhD. In addition to that, you can talk to the current graduate students, and among the things that you should ask are, what types of methods are they encouraging you to learn, and what types of equipment are they encouraging you to work on? That will give you a sense of the research and mentor style and what they're kind of nudging their current students to do. And maybe that aligns with what you want to do, maybe it doesn't. Now, the harder thing to figure out is the research vision. Does someone's research vision match your own? I think the way to understand that is really by speaking with someone, hearing about what they think their long-term goals are for their research, how they like a project to unfold. So one thing you can ask a PhD advisor is, you know, what would a project for a first-year student look like? What would your expectations be? And that's a very common question. Everyone's gonna ask that. But then you follow up and say, then what are your expectations for how that changes for someone's third year and someone's fifth year? That progression, that change from the first to the third to the fifth, will give you a sense of their vision for an ideal PhD student, how their research changes and evolves. So you can see if that aligns with how you imagine your own research evolving. Okay, so I'm talking about cases where you have all of the options available to you. You can have your pick of advisors. That is not always the case. It's gonna be increasingly more the case that it's gonna be more and more competitive to get into these labs for various reasons going on, especially in the US right now. So you might not have the ability to pick and choose different advisors based on fit. You might have a slightly awkward fit. So what do you do in that case? Now, I think the most important thing to think about is your advisor is one person, and they're not gonna be able to give you everything. It's like being in a relationship and you expect your partner to do everything. They have to be your emotional support and your family connection and your entertainment and all, you know, everything, right? One person cannot be everything. Same with an advisor. This person cannot be everything. So what you'll want to identify is if there is a mismatch, having more of an advising team. So for your research topic, your advisor might be an expert in X, but you want to integrate two fields. So expecting that advisor then to learn the second field is not appropriate. They will not learn things for your PhD. You get to learn, right? And the way that you make sure you're learning in a way that's supported by research is you pull in another advisor. You create an advising team based on all of the major components of the work. I've seen that be very, very successful. And the trick is that you want a group of people who can work together and don't disagree on everything. So it's best if they know one another. So my advice to you is if there is a mismatch, talk to your advisor and say, listen, I think you're a wonderful expert in this area. I would love to pull in someone else who's an expert in this other area because I need support from both places. They will likely have advice for you for who to reach out to because they will have thoughts as well. They will have thoughts about the people they like, the people they don't like, because you're kind of building a collaboration and there's gonna be people that they do and do not want to collaborate with. So you want to build a cohesive team and they will have thoughts about how to do that. But you really need to be proactive and suggest that maybe there's a mentorship team that would be appropriate. And there's two ways to do it. One is a formal mentorship team. This is where you have a secondary advisor on the books. Another one is informal, where you're just bringing people together to collaborate. The trick is you want to bring your advisor in this process, rather than building these teams by yourself and showing up to your advisor and saying, hey, here's my team. that won't go over well. You need to involve them because they will have thoughts and they will mentor you in this process because they have built a career, and among the things that they have learned is how to collaborate with people. And another thing that you want to consider if there's a bit of a mismatch is that your interests might change. What I wanted to study going into my PhD is not at all what I ended up studying at the end of my PhD. I ended up changing, trying things out from time to time. So if I had evaluated the current person that was my PhD advisor just purely based on fit, there would have been a big misalignment between what she was researching and what I wanted to research. Instead, I prioritized someone who I thought could help me grow as a PhD student and was willing to explore topics that weren't necessarily her main area. That can be a very unique person. Not all PhD advisors are like that. I do know some PhD advisors who have a very clear mission for their research in their lab, and they only want to study what is in that scope of research, their research program. And there's other advisors who are more interested in kind of facilitating the ideas of their PhD students. So they end up working on a big range of things based on what their PhD students are interested in. So consider that when you are thinking about potential PhD advisors. It could be that you know exactly what you want and you're never going to change. Good for you. So you should work with an advisor who has a really clear mission and your mission aligns with theirs, and you will be happy as can be. If you're someone who is maybe a little new to this, not 100% sure about what you want to study, consider working with someone who has a bigger range of interests, and they will help you kind of find your fit and be willing to go with you down certain ideas that might not be as central to their research, but could really help you grow. Now, the way to figure out if someone is the type A person where they have a primary research goal and someone who has a broader range of interests is to, of course, speak with them. You can kind of ask questions to get at this, but I think a better signal is to look at their most recent publications in the last 5 years. If they are all on the same topic, you best believe they were able to get all of their postdocs and students all on board to research that one thing. It's quite hard to do. If there's a range, that means that they're willing to work with people and they have more flexibility in their mentoring style. I hope you found this video useful. These are really general words of wisdom that I have discovered when trying to find a good fit for myself when I was applying to graduate school and seeing students apply to work with me. Now, I don't always just accept students who have a perfect fit for my research interests. Sometimes it's more of a personality fit where I think this person and I could do wonderful work together. I'm confident that because of our working styles, whatever we work on will be great. So that is another approach as well, to rather than just finding a pure research fit. So I kind of go back and forth in terms of prioritizing research fit over other things. I think you need to know yourself. If really you're very, you know, strong-minded and you know exactly what you want to do and you don't think you will change, prioritizing research fit can be very good. But you could also prioritize a working relationship, someone that you think that you could do high quality work with. That could be one way of prioritizing which PhD advisor to pick and select. But there's many other ones as well. You might need to prioritize a geographic region or maybe a new method that you want to study, etc. This is just one approach that I think is fairly sound, but definitely has some caveats. But really just go with your gut. I think that is a really good indicator of what will be successful. Please consider liking this video if you found this information useful, and subscribe for more content on academic success. Take care.